Musical Talk, the UK's independent musical theatre podcast. Hello, and welcome to this edition of Musical Talk. I'm Thos Ribbits. Well, actually, I'm Thos Ribbits, but I thought I might do the introduction today with a different voice and with different intonation, just to stop me falling into a rut or being kicked into a ditch. Well, we're still talking about the wonderful Edinburgh Fringe 2013 here on Musical Talk. And as you know, over these few weeks, I've been linking episodes together in a somewhat arbitrary way under an umbrella or theme. And today's episode is subtitled You've Been Framed. And the reason for that is because each of the four shows about which you're going to hear in-depth discussions today do something unusual with the format of musical theatre. In that the show being discussed, if you'd seen it in the theatre, would have been framed in an unusual way. And the four shows today are Get Got, Eurobeat, almost Eurovision, Sarajevo, 35mm, a musical exhibition, and Title of Show. And each of those shows got so many stars, this episode is positively a constellation in its own right. So, let's get the ball rolling. And that's an entirely appropriate phrase because the show we're going to start with today is, ironically, the show I finished my tour of Edinburgh with. And in so doing, I had a ball. The show's title is Get Got. And it's one of the musicals that people were talking about in Edinburgh. It had a twist at the end, which I'm not going to reveal. And people had been hooked by that narrative device and were talking about it. I was certainly told by various people I spoke to or chatted to or interviewed that it was a show that I should see. I was already going to go and see it, but it's nice to have your opinions backed up before you've had a chance to see the show. And people wanted to know what I thought about the way it resolved itself and the piece overall. Well, in short, I thought it was a 5-star show. I was completely blown away by it. But there is no doubting it's an unusual format for a musical theatre piece, because it purports to be the setup for and then the live broadcast of an American television practical joke and chat show, if you get my drift. The fictional show that we're watching, and we the audience are the audience of this television programme, is called Showbiz Today, Tonight. And you start in the warm-up to that show with the production manager telling you how the ensuing live programme will proceed and what our role as the audience would be, which is essentially to laugh and clap at the right moments. And then the show itself starts. You get the theme tune, you get a cameraman, and then of course you get the host and his sidekick and the guests coming on one by one. And the conceit of the programme is that the host is fairly acerbic. He interviews people who are in show business, who have got something coming up, who've got a book or a film to plug or something like that. But he also plays random practical jokes on them periodically, known as the Get Got, which is essentially the phrase used for their being had. And then the show proceeds. And of course, because it's American television, there are commercial breaks. And in the commercial breaks, i.e. downtime between the live parts of a show, you get to see the real characters coming out of the protagonists that you've been watching, both the guests, the host, and indeed some of the production staff of the TV programme. And of course, like so many of these programmes, there's a live band in the corner. And it's an amazing band, or it certainly was the day I went to see it. And you'll hear just a touch of them in a moment. But I don't mind telling you, you're completely drawn into this show from the very first. You believe the world that's being portrayed, and that means that you're so much more intimately connected with the show than perhaps other shows. And because all the songs are diegetic, by which I mean when they're sung, they're supposed to be sung, it's not just somebody's emotion taking the better of them and making them sing. Each of the songs sung in the show are songs sung because the character now says, I am going to sing a song. It's part of a narrative. So all the songs are diegetic, which means that there's never that break in reality that can sometimes occur in normal, in speech marks, musical theatre. Well, that's enough of me droning on. Let's get on to the meat of this discussion on this fabulous 5-star show, Get Got. In a minute, you'll hear my conversation with the wonderful people behind it, Colin Chaston, Nick Masitti, Stephen Faulkner, and then shortly into the conversation, you'll hear that we're joined by Charles Czarnecki. But to take us there, let's listen to one of the songs from the fantastic tie-in album, The Music from Get Got. And it's the theme tune to the television programme Showbiz Today, Tonight. Mm-hmm.
And that's how it's gotta go on showbiz today, tonight.
I'm Colin Chaston, I'm the lead producer of Get Got and the original creator, and I've worked with some of the lyrics as well.
My name is Stephen Faulkner and I wrote the book along with Nick for Get Got.
My name is Nick Masitti. I am the composer, lyricist and co-book writer for Get Got.
So we have the inspiration and creatives behind the show here. So I suppose the first question must be, how did Get Got get to be, if I can say that?
Okay, I think that's for me. I originally started writing what is now Get Got in 2002. In 2004, there was a production upstairs at the Gatehouse in London called Tsarinas, and it was well enough received to prompt me to take it further. We had a regional production in 2007. And because of the production credit sale, I was invited to take it to New York for the Midtown International Theatre Festival, where it won Best Musical, Best Costumes and Best Choreography, nominated for 10 awards.
Which isn't bad, is it?
That was great. However, at the time, I appreciated that if it was going to move forward, it needed to have a contemporary pop rock score and a new book. And that's where these guys come in, Nick and Stephen.
So all it needed was a new story and new music?
The concept was still the same, but the story was slightly different and the music was different.
It makes it a bit more contemporary.
Yes, absolutely.
Although in many ways this production very much, is, to my understanding of it, mirrors stuff that happened in almost the original, right?
That's correct, yeah.
So it's still a great debt to its original version.
Oh, hell yeah.
Well, good, because if the original... I didn't see the original version, I'm sad to say, but this was so good. But if there's a kernel of what was in it in the past, then, you know, forgive me, it's building on excellence already, if I may say. So how did you contact, you know, when you decided that it needed to be given its sort of slightly more contemporary coat of paint, should we say?
Well,
how do you find someone to do that?
After the Midtown International Theatre Festival, I was introduced to Nick, mm-hmm. and I recognised that Nick was the person to actually write the music and write the lyrics and also the book for the show. And
well, the book was interesting because there was sort of talk about who was gonna take it over, and I was just like, you know, guys,
I could try it, give me a shot.
Sort of worked, you know? So
Yourself forward and see what happens.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. It was one of those things where it was just originally like, you know, we want this this song to have more of a contemporary feel. At the time, it was like when we wanted to sound like Katy Perry or Lady Gaga. And then they're like, wow, that was great. Can you do, you know, more of them? And I was just only happy to say, sure. I mean, I've been loving musical theater in a really oddly specific way, more akin to like the old songbook. Since, I mean, I'm a jazz player, so I was trained on all that stuff, All the Things You Are, Stella by Starlight, all that stuff.
So you can write contemporarily, but you have an appreciation of the past as well.
Oh my God, I love the past. In fact,
you are
I was
son of Tim Panone.
I mean, I was just talking to our Grand executive.
yes, you are. These days it would be grandsons.
I was just talking to Charles Zarnecki, who we really should mention at every turn for helping to shape this thing. He's their executive artistic producer and musical director. About how my favorite tunes are actually probably Kirazar and Puppet Master from a theory standpoint, because what they do is actually take a lot of conventions that you would find in an old 32-bar standard and just like, I mean, Puppet Master takes the 1-6-4-5 progression and runs it backwards and somehow makes it work. And I'm really like, it was a total accident that it happened, and that's, you know, so yeah, I'm always messing around with the old stuff to try to come up with some new stuff, you know. That's what I'd like to do.
It's a twist on the classic in some sense.
That's what I'd like to do.
And when did you join the project?
I was contacted in January. I've known Nick for a long time, and I submitted my a couple of spec scripts actually that I wrote for TV, and they liked it and got back to me, and I then spent the next it's been like 6 months writing what is now Get Got, and it really came to life in the end, and I'm pretty proud of it.
I tell you what I love about it. I mean, it works from beginning to end with 100% professionalism. But what I love about it is it's the dark edges, but the fact that it is exploring, in some ways, the shallowness of current media-obsessed culture, whilst using the tropes of that culture to reveal itself. So there's, you know, it's got a lot to say. You can either take it flatly as what it's attempting to do, you know, it's a chat show that goes wrong, or you can draw from that darker pools of human failure and evil and wrong and, you know, with tragic consequences, which we won't explain here because it's got a beautiful, beautiful twist at the end, which I think works to a T.
Yes, M. Night Shyamalan would be proud.
And even as we speak, we've been joined by one of your colleagues, one of the other creatives.
This is Charles Zarnecki. I'm the executive artistic producer of, and also the music director for the production at The Fringe.
You've been praised before you arrived, so you've got nothing to worry about here. You're amongst friends.
There we go.
And this far into production, if you're still friends, that's a good sign, as far as I'm concerned. When, you know, forgive me, it, as we were saying, it is... It explores the unpleasant underbelly, shall we say, of current culture. That was always an intention? That was in the original? It's been brought out brilliantly here.
It was in the original, and then it sort of drifted away from that a little bit for the New York production, but I'm glad to say that we've come back to that.
It gives it a nice little sort of toothy edge, if I may say. There's, you know, it's just that little bit of grit in your oyster, if you don't mind saying. Yeah. I like that.
I've always been obsessed with the pieces of art that do that, you know, like Dr. Strangelove or No Country for Old Men. I mean, just what they do there off screen is amazing, and so I... You know, me and Stephen Colin fought very hard to try to get that edge back in there, because it was important for us not to sanitize this, not to, you know, wrap it up in a little bow. You know, the show is called Get Got. There's a prank that's called Get Got that they do, and, you know...
It is catching celebrities out, essentially, is the one of the things in the TV program. We are the live audience,
exactly.
The audience watching.
And, but ultimately, as the live audience, who gets really get-gotted... At the end, you know, we hope, or, you know, we want the audience not to give too much of that away,
no.
But, you know, blah, blah, blah.
It has a very good twist at the end, which, you know, forgive me, straight out of the Roald Dahl, not that you've taken it from him, but, you know, that kind of beautiful, turn the last page and, oh, your world changes around the story that you've got. Mm-hmm. I like that a great deal. It's dramatically extremely strong. In some senses, it's a drama first with music. How would you describe its tone?
Absolutely say yes, it is a drama with music. And I described it, I think in some blurb that I did a little while ago, as decidedly not musical theatre and deliciously different. So,
and yet absolutely within the world of musical theatre. I mean, you're right, its differences make it part of the mainstream, I think, in that sense. You know, it's that sounds like I'm talking nonsense, but there is some sense in there somewhere.
You're you know, absolutely you right. It, yeah.
It's within the world of, within the standard of entertainment, for sure. But it is our biggest strength and our biggest downfall is the fact that it can't be categorized specifically for something like The Fringe, but it is extremely accessible to society and to different audiences of all ages.
Seems to work just as well in Britain as it does in America, and one can hope that it works in Ireland or Australia or wherever else it ends up.
Well, I think we recognize something of what's going on, even though it's set in an American TV studio.
Yes.
But that in itself, you know, the format it's following is recognisable in, well, any Western culture, I suspect. Certainly any culture that's got tabloids and pop. And just to name two things.
And every culture, some cultures are more modelled after the Western, and some cultures have their own pop culture. But no matter what, they're both defined in some way within, I think, the confines of this piece, that's for sure.
It's also interesting, isn't it? Because it's a drama first, but with music. But the music is, you know, let's talk about diegetic and non-diegetic music. Each of the bits of music are what you would expect to see if you saw that television program. So no one breaks into song because they're expressing the emotion. They break into song because they've been hired to sing a song.
Right.
I like that.
Exactly.
But that's very unusual for a musical.
Well, it's absolutely necessary for the concept of this piece, because the realism is first and foremost with it. We can't go to
There's no jazz hands.
I know. Yeah. No jazz hands.
And I loved it anyway.
Yeah.
Some twerking. No jazz hands.
And your band is absolutely spot on. I mean,
well, thank you.
Forgive me. It has power. It has verve. And, you know, I'll be honest, it's not the kind of music I would naturally listen to at home. I must be honest. You know, I'm much more down the Tin Pan Alley route from 50, 60, 100 years ago. but it's absolutely entertaining. It's absolutely of its kind. And it's, you know, although it's, you know, these haven't been in the charts, they had the feeling that I feel that I know them. And I mean that positively. Yeah. But you've picked up the traits that we'd expect in contemporary culture.
You know, in a musical standpoint, there is a touch of the theory that, you know, informs the American songbook in pretty much every single song. There is a taste of the familiar all the way back to the beginning of musical theater, which is how we hope to hook someone such as yourself, who probably does, you know, pop music is a thing that even I don't frankly enjoy it all that much, but we're hoping to just sort of get in there.
Oh, I'm older and bolder than you. I have every reason. So. I'm allowed. I love what you were saying earlier, that you took some of the structures and did them backwards. So, forgive me, that's a literal twist on how to write a pop song.
Backcycling has always excited me, but that's the subject of just, you know, a music techie interview, you know.
So it's been well received, hasn't it? I mean, people have been talking about Get Got around Edinburgh. When I've mentioned, well, in fact, people have said to me when they're saying, what are you seeing up here? They've said, and be sure to see Get Got. It's got a great twist. I mean, none of them would tell me what it was.
That is so sweet to hear. You know, you live in an 11-person apartment. You know, you eat the same Tesco egg and cress sandwich every day. And
we feel your pain.
You know, you don't know what people are saying. So
you put a plank on the bedstead and you've got a bunk bed. I know how it works.
The road works at 7 a.m. every morning.
Yeah. But people are talking about it, and that must be quite gratifying. You've been getting the reviews, I think, as well, haven't you?
Yeah.
There's some stars twinkling.
We've had some wonderful reviews, fantastic reviews, so we're really pleased.
Yes. It's a powerhouse of a modern musical, and that alone makes it unusual, I think. And unusual in a really good way. So I suppose the question I've got to ask is, how can people see it now in Edinburgh, and is it going anywhere afterwards? It's no wrong answer to this question, by the way.
Yes, it is going somewhere, although at the moment we haven't decided.
We haven't decided what the best thing is.
In negotiation, but it's certainly not finishing up here in Edinburgh.
The important thing is we have options, you know? Yeah. That's a good thing.
Yeah.
So, but how long is it up here in Edinburgh for?
We're planning to tour the 26th of August.
Oh, you're going through to the bank holiday, Ian?
Absolutely, yes.
To the bitter
to
end.
To the bitter end.
The last show going.
Hopefully not so bitter.
No, we're very happy. I mean, you are the last show I'm seeing up here, and you're going to be sending me home on the train with a smile on my face.
Oh, wonderful.
That's fantastic.
And also because I shall be, not just passively because I enjoyed it, because I will be thinking about it, because as I say, there's this is an odd thing to say, there's hidden meat on the bone.
Yeah, the goal of the ending really was, it's one of those things, hopefully, that people leave and someone that didn't see it asks them, what did you think? And they can't answer right away.
they have to chew it over.
Yeah, they have to tell their friend, give me a little while and then I'll let you know.
Well, there's a lovely moment without, you know, after the twist has occurred, when the audience doesn't respond. They don't know if they have to clap, you know, and that's lovely. That's a moment of digestion. You're saying, it sounds horrible, but there were, you know, 100 people in the room digesting in a positive way. That's, well, I meant it positively anyway. So.
And the pre-show is interesting as well. I've stood there and I've watched people sort of pretend not to hear what's going on, nudging their partner and saying, have you heard that? What are we letting ourselves in for?
And yeah, because it's done as real, isn't it?
Absolutely.
People interact in very intense ways as well, which is wonderful, because that's exactly why we're doing this production here in Edinburgh, to see how people react to it, and those are the reactions that we want. We're seeing all the reactions that we had hoped for. So, yeah.
Well, the audience is as much a part of any show as well. I mean, you know, the audience tells you where you're strong and where you're weak, and an audience will be different every night, so you must have different responses.
And absolutely, and our audience are another character in the production.
But there will be people who, well, first of all, can't make it up to Edinburgh, and will also want to know if it is going on somewhere else, as you said it should be, and hopefully will be. So where can they go? What are your websites? What are your contact details?
They should come to www.getgotshow.tumblr.com. Tumblr is T-U-M-B-L-E-R.
Yeah, no E, isn't it?
That's no E, no E. So getgotshow.tumblr.com.
A thing to add also for people who haven't checked out the show is that there is a wonderful cast album produced by Charles.
Co-produced by Nick Mazzitti.
That's just going
to
make
an additional music to add to the concept, and that's called The Music of Get Got. Yeah. And you can find that on iTunes and any number of other things.
It's available for the
absolutely.
Wide.
It's available right there.
It's available at the box office, and it's available on iTunes and a couple other websites that you can find. But the Tumblr is the hub for our media.
That's the starting point to go to.
Right, and you can also go to, we have a fan page on Facebook as well, so that's very easy to find as well.
Oh, there's public swelling of support.
Oh, yeah,
and the album, I think we must say, is also the backstory of the show.
Right.
Oh, right, so it's sort of...
It's a very high concept album.
The credits are all accurate.
Yeah, to the characters. Mm-hmm. Well, to the people, that's just...
To the people, yes.
To the people.
I like the idea of contextualizing a show after you've seen it. That's such an unusual way forward. Right. I think that's fabulous.
But we've actually contextualized it before it was even the version that you witness right now in Edinburgh. All of that concept and everything, this piece exists within somehow. And that album that supports that concept has been in the radio waves for quite a while.
And that's
already
an important thing, I think, to highlight upon, which is that in a lot of ways, Get Got is more than the theater piece that you've just seen. It's it's a universe.
It's a continuum, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes. And this is just a section of it.
It's just a section of it.
Well, you know what that says. Sequel!
Stephen's already at work.
Yes. See you next year.
Sydney's Revenge.
I already know the title.
Okay. I hope it's going to be two words with just one vowel change, though, because that's important for a continuity.
Fair enough.
Well, gentlemen, I have to say, you've got a cracking show. It's a 5-star show, absolutely without a doubt. I'd commend it to everybody. So thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
Thank you. You've made my life.
Musical talk. Well, there we have it. That's Get Got and the people behind Get Got. And I'm delighted that I got the chance to get to talk to them. They have written a remarkable show, and I'm grateful that they've let me play one of the pieces of music from it. Remember, that album is available, and you heard the quality of the band on the recording. You can imagine what it was like actually in the theatre. And I gave that show 5 stars and said what a modern musical should be. It's a remarkable, wonderful piece. If you get a chance to catch it in any future versions, do so. You won't regret it. So that was Get Got, where the framing device was that you were watching a live show taking place before you, which is not a million miles from the framing device of the second show we're going to be talking about today, which is Eurobeat, almost Eurovision, Sarajevo. It does have the name of that city in brackets at the end of it. And as that title suggests, Eurobeat is a fantastic musical purporting to be the final of the Eurovision Song Contest, taking place in that year, and whatever year it is we don't know, in Sarajevo. It has a beautiful, glamorous female host, a slightly squarer male host, and then each of the countries are portrayed with a song which somehow seems to fit what that country is famous for or is known for presenting at the Eurovision Song Contest. It's a fantastic way of exploring in a cheeky, tongue-in-cheek way some of the tropes and memes of the Eurovision Song Contest and the intercultural relationships that we all share by being part of that. You don't have to be a fan of the Eurovision Song Contest to enjoy this show, but if you are, I do think it would pay off. But what an amazing show in terms of atmosphere. On the way in, you can hear that the auditorium of the theatre is already alive with the audience. I have never known a show where the audience were so geared up, so excited prior to the show starting. We were all presented with different European flags so that we could root for the country that we'd been given. In my case, I was given Germany. And you also had little tooting horns, and I have mine here with me. So imagine this sound reverberating around a small, intimate theatre auditorium. And that's not all, because each audience member was presented with a pair of clackers, which is a kind of small handheld apparatus, which when you shook it, made the sound of clapping. So imagine the two of those sounds together in a room. It had the same atmosphere, I imagine, of attending the World Cup final. And the show itself was fantastic. I hadn't seen it before, although I knew it had been in London a few years ago. But I'm such a convert, I would see it anywhere at any time because it's such fun. That is the word that overwhelmingly describes this show. It was beautifully put on by a young cast from Wellington College, and they squeezed every possible laugh out of the whole process. After I'd seen the show, I gave it 5 stars and was delighted to speak to Sarah Spencer, who's one of the directors. And this is the conversation I had with her about Eurobeat, almost Eurovision, Sarajevo. Musical talk.
So my name's Sarah Spencer and I'm the director of 2 shows in the Edinburgh Fringe this year, Eurobeat and Waiting for the Call, the improvised musical, both at sea venues.
Well, we'll talk about the second one in a minute because it's in a long train of tradition of improvised musicals, which are, you know, it's almost a hothouse breeding ground here in Edinburgh. But I'd really like to talk to you about Eurobeat.
Ah, Eurobeat.
Now, Eurobeat is a show that has history already in Edinburgh and, let me say this immediately, has the most intoxicating, exciting and fantastic atmosphere of any show I've ever experienced in Edinburgh. In a complimentary way, that's meant.
Oh, thank you. It's quite a phenomenon, that show. Honestly, I saw the original in Edinburgh a few years ago and then I followed it to the West End and exactly what you said, it is the most exciting show as an audience member, but not to mention as a cast member as well, because honestly, it's like a different show every night. My cast is fairly young. They're 17 and 18 years old and I think actually, obviously the West End cast is fantastic, but my guys bring a certain sort of youthful energy to it and the sense of competition as well.
There's real power, if I may say, you know, just a desire to do well and to be exciting, and if I may say, energy that wore me out from my seat in the audience.
Try living with them in a flat with 25.
I was going to say, how big is the cast all together with crew and things?
At full strength, the cast is 20, although we were 18 today because various sort of commitments, yeah. people have disappeared. So 20 at full strength in the cast, 2 directors, so me and my colleague Rosal Smith. I've got a technical team of 2. But to be honest, Rose and I are pretty much responsible for everything backstage, from the making of the costumes to the design of the sound and the lighting. And yeah, we're at Wellington College, we're a bit of a theatre company in training, really, as opposed to a school.
So where are you based?
We're based in somewhere you'll never have heard of, Crowthorne in Berkshire.
You are correct.
Yes, you'll never have heard of it. Let me give you a geographical reference. Probably Reading is the closest place. I've been at Wellington College since 2006. You probably know it best as probably a boys' boarding school, but it went co-ed a few years ago. And I came in, I was an advanced skills drama teacher from inner city London. And I guess I was just asked to give it a bit of a kick up the bum in drama terms. And because my background is cabaret, first thing I thought was let's get some silly, fun, energetic musicals on the plate. So our structure of the year is we do 8 shows a year. Four of those are musical theatre shows. Rose and I are rehearsing continuously throughout the year 4 shows at once. So on a Monday we're rehearsing Miss Saigon, and then Tuesday we might be doing something else. But we're lucky because what emerged over the 7 years I've been there is that we have a young cast like I have never seen before. They have just an absolute hunger to perform, and it's astonishing.
And hopefully we'll go on to perform professionally thereafter once this is it.
I think we've challenged the preconceived idea that, you know, if you go to a boarding school, you're going to go on to Oxford or Cambridge. Actually, we're filtering them through to drama schools. I've got a few at Drama Centre. I've had one at East 15. We've got a couple. Never got them into RADA, but I think I seem to be producing kind of quirky kids that are going down the sort of avant-garde route
as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And the ones that haven't gone to drama school are doing it at university. We've got a good few in Bristol this year, some in Exeter. So yeah, we're getting out there.
So how did you alight upon Eurobeat for this year's Edinburgh? I mean, was it always your intention to do a show that came to Edinburgh?
Yes.
And it was. And when did you think, this is the one for me?
Well, last year we did Hamlet the musical, and in Edinburgh terms, that's pretty much the perfect show. It's short, it's funny, it's snappy, it has a big cast, but you can multi-role. And I did look at many, many shows, and I just thought, after last year, we need something with the same energy. And then I remembered having seen Eurobeat in the West End. In the West End, you probably remember it was in two parts. So all we essentially did was adapt it for our own purposes with the permission of Joseph Weinberg, and we lopped off the second half, put the big Sarajevo number to close the show, which I think actually works really well, and edited a couple of acts out to make it a perfect
hour.
Yes. Exactly. And the brilliant thing is, it's been so easy to rehearse because you can do it in chunks. And I forgot to say, we've also choreographed this as well, and our young cast has had such good impact with things like the Grease routine, because there's obviously contemporary moves that we have no idea about that they've stuck in there. But it's been a pleasure, and as shows go, relatively quick to put together.
Relatively. I've got to ask, because as you say, Eurobeat it's been up to Edinburgh before.
Yeah.
It's got a history of its own.
Of course.
So it was written a small number of years ago.
Yeah, yeah.
And Eurovision as a contest changes and stays the same in a very odd way.
Yes.
So did you find, coming to this text, that there were tropes and things within it that no longer seem to resonate quite so much? And were you, you know, how much leeway were you allowed to have? Or how did your young cast, who are, how old would you say?
Average age, 17, I'd say.
How did they respond to some of these things, which, you know, for me, I'm much older than everyone here, as a middle-aged man would recognise from the last 20, 30 years of Eurovision?
Well, interestingly, I suppose maybe not surprisingly, our kids, our cast, had never seen Eurovision before. So I know, it's hard to believe.
I believe is the official response.
I know, they're musical theatre students, how could they not have seen Eurovision?
Well, and that so does actually answer its own
well,
question.
Exactly. So we had to sit down with them and sort of show them clips. So that honestly, they said, no, that's a prestige. Surely that did not really go into the Eurovision Song Contest. And once they understood that, they had more of a handle on the fact that actually we're not playing this for laughs, we're playing this for real. And especially the Poland routine, where the guys strip off to the hot pants, there is a clip of that happening. It wasn't Poland, but it happened.
Well, we all know that the removal of lower garments has
been
invoked
Bucks
since
Fizz.
Bucks Fizz.
Exactly.
Yes, you know, that watershed moment for all sexes thereafter.
I know.
Where will it end?
And hopefully we've recreated that for you in the show a number of times.
There was a lot of hot vest action as well on the chaps.
Oh, my goodness, the chaps love a hot vest. They really do. But no, in answer to your question, it was a question of kind of showing them that actually people do take this very seriously.
Yeah.
We're about the only nation in the world that takes the mickey out of it. Everyone else takes it very seriously.
We still want to win, though.
We do. And actually, I would say, how many times has our UK entry won? About three times. So they're playing it to win. The only act that I lost was Iceland. And probably when it was performed in the West End, the Bjork reference was quite contemporary.
Yeah.
But for us, it actually isn't at all.
She came and she went. I know she's still around, but not in terms of popular culture.
Well, in terms of my 18-year-olds, absolutely no idea at all. So I lost that one. But with regards to the modernisation of it, yes, I suppose the backing track does sound a little bit of its era, but actually that's half the fun of it. And the modernising of the routines, I think, brings it bang up to date.
So how do you choreograph? I mean, the thing about Eurobeat, for people who don't know, is it's got a keen observer's eye on what you'll get if you watch a full Eurovision. You know, there's at least one country that always has the traditional folk song.
Of course.
And Hungary is the opportunity here with our Little Birds.
Absolutely.
Which is actually, I think, should have won. And my colleague here voted for, yes.
Well, I tell you what, Little Birds has won, I would say, about eight times.
Oh, really?
Eight times. We had a pre-Edinburgh run where we did a sort of local performance centre. And everybody loves Hungary. Yet in rehearsal, that's the one that we thought, I'm not sure that's going to come across. But it's been universally loved.
But there are other tropes, aren't there? There's you know, the unnecessary rap section. Oh, in there's a boy band.
The obligatory rap section.
And then, of course, things you associate more with national culture, like the German one is Autobahn kind of electropop, minimalist. So, but how do you, approaching this as a director and a choreographer, make it both recognisable for what it's trying to do, and of course, as you say, more contemporary and fun? You know, it's got to be a show for now, not a show for 2 years ago.
Well, exactly. I guess obviously the starting point is to look at as many clips as we can to find out what the intention was originally with the scene. But actually, to be fair, we didn't find that many. So it was a question of really sort of reinterpreting it, how we wanted to do it. Our cast, I must say, have so much input into how the show develops. Certainly the Hungary routine. That was a question for us of just making interesting patterns because the performance space that we did it in originally was more of a sort of traditional proscenium arch with people looking down. So I guess it's been quite organic. It's adapted, because obviously we're on three sides for this one. It's adapted for the performance space.
It's like a thrust, isn't it?
Well, exactly. Yeah. I certainly would not say I'm the best choreographer in the world, but I can certainly do armography and patterns on the floor. And that gets me through.
Also, though, if you didn't rest on your laurels, I'll pay you a great compliment. Well, I mean it as a great compliment. For example, in the Hungarian one, where the four Hungarian maidens are joined by sort of sub-ballet dancing fellas.
Oh, yeah.
And they all run around in circles.
Yeah.
Every time they came around, they took a different pose. So it wasn't the same thing over and over.
Yeah.
It was a slightly different striking of a pose.
Well,
we tried to find
a signature move, you're quite right. And with Hungary, it was the jerking of the head. So once we'd kind of incorporated the signature move that country was going to have, in Sweden, it was the pose with the arms outstretched. It was just a question of striking that pose in as many ways as we could. Things find their own pattern, really.
Do you have a particular favourite from any of the... I mean, how many countries did we get?
Well, there's nine. There should be 10. My favourite entry has never won. I can't understand it. Sweden.
Well, which is the ABBA rip-off, isn't it?
Sweden.
I mean, let's be honest.
I love the facial expressions. I love the inane grins. Yeah. I love the slightly suggestive choreography to the boys quite kind of know what they're doing.
Well, also, I mean, the great thing about ABBA and that whole genre anyway is that there is suggestiveness in there, but it's done so wholesomely.
Yeah, with
you
a
wouldn't
smile
know it
on
if you're
your
not,
face.
Yeah, if you're not looking.
Yeah, exactly. And my other favourite act that we've been crossing our fingers all run was going to win one today, and that was Ireland.
Yes.
Yeah.
The La 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 song.
La 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 La. It's the one everybody remembers, but for some reason it just hasn't picked up the votes. But I think the crowd were really behind them today.
Do you have any surprises? You know, you've spoken about one of those shows. Has there been any country you thought this is never going to win, which has sort of crept
that
to the
has
top?
Crept up there? From my perspective, I suppose, like I said, Hungary. But actually, that works best when you put the subtitles in, because they are hilarious. Those subtitles about the chickens and the turkeys. And so that one was a bit of a stealth entry. I'd say Hungary.
Now, you've touched upon it briefly. You know, there is I'm not going to say massive suggestiveness, but there is innate sexuality in the songs, because pop is full of that kind of thing.
Of course.
And there are young men and young women. And certainly the British one, for example, there is a moment of slight naughtiness, I would say.
With a raise of an eyebrow and a few gestures.
So, forgive me, how does one draw the line? I mean, one can't be too prudish.
No, absolutely.
But one doesn't want to offend Daily Mail readers everywhere.
No, absolutely. And I think you're right. I think it is...
I don't mind at all if we do.
Maybe that's our aim.
Yes.
You're right, there is a fine line, and actually our reviews have said that we've kept exactly the right side of the line. We've had some lovely, lovely reviews. It's a difficult line to cross. Certainly, we don't cast anybody under the age of 18 in a role that would be too suggestive. But actually, the UK one is a good example. The move that we initially choreographed was a sway to the waist. But the chap's raise of the eyebrow makes it much more than it actually is. And that has developed organically over the course of the run. We don't steer away from doing things that could be said to be a little bit near the mark, but we certainly try not to overstep it.
And I don't think you did at all.
It's a difficult thing to do.
You're also riding on the atmosphere of entertainment. You know, let's talk about this again. As you go in, you're presented with a flag for any of the countries.
Yeah.
There is a little blowing horn.
The clackers.
And the clackers.
Yeah.
The sound before you come on.
That's
is
exactly
astounding.
It.
So let's talk about the linking characters. Mm. You have
Sergei and Boyka.
It's set in Sarajevo. There's a female and a male Sarajevan, for want of a better phrase. and they have this kind of odd, sparring, jealous relationship. But they also have a role, and my friend Dave made this observation quite rightly, that they actually have to keep the whole thing going.
Absolutely.
They have to have a relationship with the audience, whereas the others come on, perform and disappear again.
Mm.
They actually have, you know, they break the fourth wall.
Yeah.
How easy is that to train in an acting environment? Because it's not, I mean, acting is, it is there, but it's more than acting, isn't it? It's more than, it's more than what might be normally expected of a classical acting training.
Absolutely. We do have a certain secrets with regards to how we've cast Serge and Boyka. Boyka is the best example. She is not one of my actresses. She's an improvisational comedian.
Oh,
she's
right.
One of my 18-year-olds who is in my show that starts prior to Eurobeat, Waiting for the Call. So she's an improviser in the musical theatre long-form style. So she knows how to work a crowd. She knows how to look them in the eye. She knows how to read a crowd as well. And she'll play with things at the start, so she'll see where she can take that crowd. Boyka is the key character because Sergei is simply a foil for her.
Yeah.
So in the initial scenes, I say to her, Cici, her name is, she's actually Brazilian. You probably wouldn't, probably wouldn't have noticed. She'll go out and she'll see where the crowd want to pitch it. Depending on the makeup of the crowd, we'll see whether the men in the audience would prefer her to be a bit of a queen, a bit bitchy, or whether they'd prefer her to be on their side and clap them and cheer them. So we experiment for the first two, and like today, we said, no, they want to love you. They want to love Boyka today, so let's not play her as a meanie like we sometimes do.
Oh, that it's good to know that flexibility.
Exactly,
there,
so exactly. But it's, do you know what is a wonderful thing about Boyka is she's an absolute horror, but she's so lovable, and what a great role for a female actress to hold that together.
Yeah.
Because normally in the double act, it would be the man that gets the best lines, and he doesn't. He sets her up to give the punchline.
Yeah,
fabulous
he
role.
Is a stooge in many ways, and resented as well, which actually gives him comedy benefit, as well as giving her more room, I think.
Absolutely.
And of course, she gets the close down number as
she
well,
does.
Which is, you know, the Sarajevo turnip song, for want of a better phrase.
I mean, it's just a classic number, isn't it? We took that number out and did a late night cabaret performance with it, and it occurred to me it was so out of context. Standing at the side of the stage, I was about to send a kid on dressed as a turnip for an audience at 2 in the morning.
Who hasn't done that?
It went down well, but it was slightly bizarre. Yeah. But an amazing number.
Now, you've mentioned it, and we should. There's a second show.
There is.
And it's an improvisational musical.
Yeah.
But tell us a bit more about it, because I'm really excited by it, the fact that your school, which sounds so forward-thinking and thorough and excellent, and, you know, all praise to you, has an improvisational class, and you of sufficient quality that you can take people on the stage with
that's
it.
I'd like to think it's forward thinking. Like I said, we do so many shows. It was a question of what can we do next. And last year we were lucky enough to have some workshops with a quite remarkable baby once candy. And there's a guy called Al Samuels who's been an absolute mentor to us. He's kept in touch with us over the years, and we run a weekly 2-hour class on a Thursday evening. I've got a musical director who, to be quite honest, we couldn't do the show without, because he's creating the songs.
Yeah.
And Rose and I have, I guess probably, I don't want to pick us up a bit here, but we've kind of sort of developed our own training technique for how we're going to get them there. And it's a question really of not just helping them with rhyming and you know, constructing a song and finding your own stylistic way through it, but it's the fact that you are essentially breaking the fourth wall and you're looking the audience in the eye and you're connecting with them, but yet you have to have that engagement with your character, so that if you're doing a ballad, it's not too knowing. It's I want to go on this journey with this character. But how
and improvising with other members.
Absolutely.
If it's a musical, that's different from just doing stand-up on your own. You are liaising with other people in character.
Well, that's what I found. And we have a team that's fairly big, actually, when you look at it as who turns up every week. Well, there's 20 of them, but there's only 6 that do it to, I would say, a standard that I would consider professional enough to take to Edinburgh. And interestingly,
and
we're bonkers, we did. But interestingly, of that 6, 4 of them are female. And we've actually found that rather than it being something that, you know, maybe in the past girls would have said, oh, girls aren't funny, girls can't keep a show going.
That old
Well, exactly. We found that our female team keep it going with the teamwork and the cooperation in a way that the boys get a little bit competitive. Oh, I'm going to sing a song and I'm going to block you out and this is what's going to happen. Our ladies are quite remarkable.
Well, you don't want alpha males in an improvisational environment,
you
do
absolutely
you? It's
don't.
Got to be collegiate.
You
it
absolutely
must,
don't.
Surely, yes.
And I'm so proud of them, so proud of them. And it's been a learning curve, but Baby Wants Candy and Al, I've done us 4 workshops this week, so that's set us up for the year. And onwards and upwards, we're going to try and get regular gigs now, monthly. We're going to try and find a London small venue, because I actually think these kids are probably doing something that other students really aren't.
No, and they're not.
I want them to become the UK experts at this, so they, we can say, do you know what? Here's something that other people could think of.
That's fantastic. I do hope you'll keep in touch with me, because I'm based in London, so I'd love to come along and interview and see and discuss and review if that would be helpful.
Well, that would be amazing. And just, I think these 6 students in particular have got something, and I think you're going to see something develop that's quite interesting. I know I'm blowing the trumpet. I'm the teacher. I shouldn't do it, but my goodness. If they're this good with...
Well, now,
11 months practice, where are they going to be next year? So we'll see.
So these shows are finished in Edinburgh for this run, but I'm sure you'll be back for the future.
Oh, gosh.
You also do shows locally which people can see in the area.
Absolutely. We usually sell out, so we like people getting quick.
And you've got this potential plan for London and improvisational musicals. Tell us, how can we, the mere public, the humble paying public, how can we see some of these things?
The paying public are exactly who we want to come and see the shows. I want people to see how fantastically remarkable these kids are. Well, log on to wellingtoncollege.org.uk and have a little look at what we're up to. Certainly in terms of ones that I think you shouldn't miss, we've got a quite amazing Miss Saigon coming up, which we're getting in just before it hits the West End, so
yeah,
that should be pretty good.
You're a trailblazer.
We try. And as yet, not decided venue-wise, but track down Waiting for the Call, because I think they're the ones to watch.
Now, to take us back to Eurobeat, are there shows which you've done either in Edinburgh or with the school that haven't travelled, but you'd love to revisit? Are there some which you've done and you thought, these are so good, actually, I think, give it a couple of years and then we might try this again?
Oh, there are so many shows. The trouble is, I have to work through my own personal repertoire of favourites.
I bet it's a large repertoire as well.
There's a massive repertoire. Where can I start? I like presenting my students with things that they might not have heard of. I've got a particular love for Chorus Line. Oh, my God, I love that show. Just because, again, it's short, it's self-contained, it's silly, it's funny, it's got a heart. I love that show. But one that...
It's a singular sensation.
It's a singular sensation, absolutely. The one that we're going to try and do at Edinburgh next year that we've had a little go at, but only in workshop form, and sort of seeing what we can go with it, and this is a departure for us, is Forbidden Planet.
Oh, how interesting.
I know. I'm quite keen on the actor-musician. I think that's not a direction we've been in yet. And certainly a lot of the cast that you would have seen on stage tonight play instruments. And I want to see if I can mix that up a bit.
Yeah, make that work.
Yeah, see if I can do that in a different way.
Well, as you say, you're always trying to break the boundaries a bit, aren't you? Push that envelope. This is so marvellous. And, you know, you're giving these people the absolute foundation they need to then go on to be the stars of tomorrow.
Well, there's some real talent out there. And I have to say here and now, it's not me, it's them. We can't do anything without these quite remarkable students. So,
whilst that's true, you mustn't hide your light too much under a bushel, if I may say. There's a lot of support that goes into this.
Well,
it's been inspirational just talking to you. I wish you were my drama teacher.
Oh, well, I need to mention the quite marvellous Rosal Smith, who is sitting next to me here, who runs outreach workshops in the local community. So it would be amazing if we could do a plug for this. Poor Rose teaches drama every Saturday to around about 44-year-olds and upwards. And my goodness, I don't know how she does it. So if anyone in the Crowthorne area would like a drama workshop, a drama party, a drama club, drop us a line, because
fantastic.
I've got this lovely lady here who is more than prepared to come out and do things.
Well, there we are. That's a call to arms,
absolutely,
if I may say.
Absolutely.
Well, I have to say, the show is fantastic. And I'm going to say, it's a 5-star show.
Oh, that's so kind.
It is unstoppable, and nor should it be stopped.
Well, let's not stop it. Let's take it on tour. Let's buy a bus. That's really kind of you. We've had a 4-star review in so far, but I'll take a 5 and I'll whack it on my posters.
Splendid. Thank you so much.
And it's a pleasure.
All power to your elbow.
Thank you so much. Lovely to talk to you.
Musical Talk.
That was Sarah Spencer, and it was such a joy talking to her. She was such an inspirational person. I can imagine what it must be like to be at Wellington College with her. I wish I had been. And Eurobeat was just a vibrant, delightful show. I gave it 5 stars and described it as unstoppable fun. And so it was. when a cast is enjoying itself and an audience is enjoying itself that much, it's probably illegal. So that's two shows, so we're halfway through the programme. And both of those shows had the unusual framing device of inviting the audience to pretend or believe that they were in a real audience for a television programme going out live, with unintended consequences in one case, or giving you a chance to enjoy, in a heightened sense, a real experience that most of us will probably never get to have, which is going to the final of the Eurovision Song Contest. But the third show we're going to be talking about today is quite different, and its framing device is, well, entirely different. It's an anthology, almost. It's called 35mm, a musical exhibition, with music and lyrics by Ryan Scott Oliver, based around a photographic exhibition by Matthew Murphy. It was described on the Edinburgh Fringe website in the following way. If a picture is worth 1,000 words, then what about a song? In 35mm, each photograph creates a different song. Unique moments frozen in time. A glimmer of life unfolding. A glimpse of something happening. A series of snapshot stories held together by one overriding theme, life. I went to this show not quite knowing what to expect and was entranced. And so the moment it was over, I sat down with Katie Peskin, the director, and Michael Riley, the musical director, to talk about this most unusual show. Musical talk.
I am Katie Peskin and I am the director of the show.
I'm Michael Riley and I'm the musical director.
And this is 35mm. It's a concept show. How would you describe it? Because it's not your standard Broadway musical, is it?
It's not. In its title, it's described as a musical exhibition, which I think sums it up quite well once you've seen it, because it kind of combines the idea of it being a photography exhibition and a musical. There isn't a through line as such, obviously, that it's not got a running narrative. It's more of a series of snapshot stories. And so that's where it differs, really. It's kind of along the lines of a song cycle, to be honest, but with that added dimension of the kind of running theme of photography.
It has some classical precedents, does it not? There's pictures in an exhibition, which of course is a similar kind of thing classically. And I was getting some very strong hints in British history, in the 1930s, when Edith Sitwell, you may know, famously semi-wrapped, I think is the only way of describing it, to music by Walton. Through a megaphone. I don't know if you're aware of this, but there was very similar kind of sort of totally different bizarre things, and I was getting some of that sense, because some of the not a direct lift, you understand, yeah, but there was, you know, it's been done before at one level, but this is a popular American show, isn't it? It's been massively successful in the States, I guess.
Yeah, it was a massive hit off Broadway. The run sold out, they extended it. I think it's a concept that the American theatre world is quite used to, not having a narrative, the idea of a song cycle. And I think that we're less familiar with it over here, which makes it quite challenging to present to a British audience, I think. But it's been a massive hit over there, and they have had really big names involved with it. And Ryan Scott Oliver, who's the composer, has quite a big name out there as well now. So I think all those things combined, whereas over here it's much new. It feels much newer. Yeah. Because we don't really know about song cycles as much outside
of
the
industry.
So it feels
like a concept musical as a result. I think you're absolutely right. Your cast are fantastic.
Thank you. I'll tell them you think so.
I do think so. But there's one person, well, there's in fact two people, aren't there, who work all the way through. And that's you. You've only got one song, I think, off, which is
It lasts about 2 minutes, and it's a lovely break.
Yes, but you rest your fingers in hot water, presumably.
Yeah, I have a nice little bowl beside me, yeah.
So how do you find the score? Because, I mean, to my ear, it sounds extremely contemporary. It's actually quite hypnotic at some level. It's quite soothing, particularly in a dark auditorium, and there's no through line, so you can just take things as they come as an audience. How is it for you, and how's your concentration?
I mean, for starters, it's a very challenging score to play for both myself and Rich, the drummer.
Yes. And you are the complete orchestra between you, are you not? Yes.
Yes. Originally it was done by a band of, I believe it was six, and I sort of took it upon myself to try and create as many sounds used in the original off-Broadway production on my keyboard, which is always a difficult thing, but it is a challenging thing to overcome, but I think that it's a really, really it's a great score to play, really interesting, always challenging, and very, you have to concentrate throughout the whole show.
Well, I can see it on your face. You're also making eye contact with various of the actors, and indeed your drummer, I notice occasionally,
right.
And up to the box where you are, Katie, direction. So you you're tucked in this dark little corner.
Right.
I mean, how easy is that?
It's hard to hear a lot of the cast at a lot of the time because I'm sat nearer the amp than I am the cast, and I'm always trying to observe every aspect of the show just to make sure nothing can possibly go wrong. So I'm looking for Katie in case she's sitting at the back thinking, what are you doing, Michael?
Where did the song go? The song's gone.
But I am always trying to look out just to be sure.
And there is a richness of sound, as you say. It's interesting that between two of you, you can actually produce what sounds to me like a vast variety of things. There's some, and because also each of the songs have their own tone and feel, some the tempos are high, there's a choral piece which you're not involved in, but every song has a different feel and tone, and you've complemented that. I mean, there's one that sounds quite 70s-ish to me, or certainly, I wouldn't be able to give you the name of it, but I was getting the chap who, from the TV Charlie Brown series, was all light jazz scoring. And there was suddenly this song that came straight out of, and I thought, oh gosh, that's a light jazz motif, which I wasn't expecting as the next number. Musically, you feel on top of it.
It's one of those songs that you have to very early on make sense when studying it through with the cast, because they're always changing lines very quickly, more than any other song. Am I on the right song? I think this is the right one.
You say what you think it is.
Right, that's what I thought.
And so it's one of those you have to get to grips with as soon as possible. But once you've got that, it's just a matter of going through it many times and coming up with different solutions of how it and what it can mean. And yeah, that was one of the more challenging songs.
It's a tough thing. The whole show's a tough thing. They just don't stop throughout.
No.
So they're pretty knackered by the end of it.
And some of the songs, interestingly, I think, feel like they're coming to an end and then they don't quite. And some are quite lengthy, aren't they?
Yeah, there's one song that's almost 8 minutes long.
Is that Luan?
Yeah, Leave Luan, it's called.
And, you know, you feel you've sat through a saga, not in a bad way, but there's a real sense of, oh, an unfolding story, oh, and a bit more, and oh, it's unfolded again, oh, and here's the denouement, and now a coda.
Yeah.
You know, whoa, 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 whoa. It's fabulous. I love your staging, by the way.
Oh, thank you very much.
You know, you've got two huge frames from which are hanging books, from which are hanging props, and then for each number a specific prop or two is pulled off until you're left with the bare bones of what you've got left.
Mm.
You know, you do get a sense of an exhibition being explored and perhaps sucked dry, to use another song as well, you know.
Yeah, I think it's a challenging show because it is just the music. There's no narrative, there's no dialogue. So the whole kind of conceptualization of how you're going to stage it is down to the team doing it in every individual production.
Yeah, you've got to be fresh all the way, isn't it? Because you just can't rely on the narrative per se.
No.
Yeah, in a way, sometimes you can think,
Of characters and stuff, because they're constantly changing.
Yeah.
And I think cause it hasn't been done over here before. It's not been done outside America.
Is this the UK premiere?
European premiere.
Goodness
indeed.
Me. Let's not hide our light under a bushel.
No. So, which was quite refreshing in a way, because it meant that we were completely free to do what we wanted to it, and not kind of coloured by having seen other things, and audiences having seen other things.
Interestingly, though, I think, you know, there's a, as well as the props and the actors and the musicians on stage, you've also got projected on your back wall some photographic imagery, and these have a connection. Not always a direct connection with the songs as well.
The songs were all written inspired by the photograph that's projected during them.
Yeah, so the old question of what comes first, the lyrics or the words, is now what comes first, the pictures or the music?
Yeah, and in this case, all except one song, it's the pictures, came first, which I think is really interesting because some of the links are not clear when you first hear the songs and see the images.
Bleak.
You have to really look for it, and I think in that sense it's quite challenging for an audience because that's like the one thing they've got to hook into. But it's quite nice to have a bit of a question mark for the audience.
It's not like the 10 o'clock news where they show you a picture of what you're talking about.
Yeah.
They do show you a picture of what you're talking about, but it's slightly oblique. They are great pictures in their own right, you know, artistically. There's no doubt about it.
Yeah, I love the photographs.
And they are the same photographs in the American show. You know, they are dedicated. So if anyone does a franchise version of this particular musical, they'll always have those photographs.
Yeah.
Did you find that constraining or positive? I mean, how did you had to interpret them first as director?
Yeah, I think I think twinning them with the song is the key to it, and because for the show they come as a pair, so you can't really separate them.
No.
And I think in some photographs and songs it's more obvious what they're saying than in others. But in all of them, once you spend a bit of time looking at it, it does become clear.
It unlocks.
Yeah, for me it does anyway.
I don't know. I've played them so many times now. That's all I can think when I see that picture. Yeah.
Well, I was going to say the same thing when you were coming to the piece musically. Maybe the better question is, are there still surprises in it? You're sort of suggesting not, but that can't be true. There must be, because the audience will always give you different kinds of feedback as well, won't they? I mean, you know, an audience, people forget, is so much part of a show, and see the same show three or four nights and you'll have a totally different show each time.
I feel like some of the songs are different every night.
Yeah.
Completely different.
That's the great thing about theatre, and every hearing it so many times. How many shows have we done all well into our...
20 maybe.
And we're about 2/3 of the way through the run of the Fringe anyway, aren't
we?
And I'm still picking up new things every show,
and you
which
are.
Is great.
Still
really
surprising.
I mean, you think you have it covered before you even do the first. You think you have it, everything sorted out, but then it surprises you how much you actually learn from.
Yeah, and also it depends massively on what the actor's feeling and when they're singing it, and where it's coming from for them on that particular night can change completely the way they sing it, which I love to watch, and I like that they're constantly engaged with it.
Well, some of the songs are quite playful, aren't they, as well? And the thing about playfulness is it's... whereas if a song is sombre or emotional, quite often it's pitched at a very similar level. But playfulness is one of those things. It's, you know, you can be very playful or slightly playful, and the audience will guide you to where they would... You know, the playfulness that they would like you to have. As sensitively, you know, forgive me, you have to be very sensitive as a musical director to that, don't you? Or do you?
Of course, it's true. It's always... my personal idea of how I see everything is just another man's opinion, but it's always vital to really take on board as much as you can from every other aspect, and along with the director come up with.
And how has your working relationship been? Because, you know, it's you are God, but God has...
I like that one. I'm going to use that, I think.
But you have your archangels. So, we're keeping with this. There was one religious number, and quite a lot of references to God in the piece.
Mm.
So, I mean, but seriously, you know, you do have to find a way of bringing your visions together. Was that easy for you? Had you worked together before?
No, we hadn't.
No, and it was from the very first day. I mean, you always have to have this level of respect for the director, because she obviously has the final say and everything, so
he is God.
Being God, I'm shaking God. To her putting across my ideas.
I think the thing is, with a show like this, it's so tough musically for the singers as well, that it's vital before I start playing around with it and getting what I want from it that they are 100% solid with what they're singing.
Yeah, they've got to get their
and
text
what they're listening
they
to. Yeah. So I think we were quite methodical about it, in the sense we just rehearsed the music for quite a long time before I went anywhere near it, and I'd just sit in the corner and make annoying suggestions, which I'd get looks from everyone about, like, you're making it harder for us. And then after they were kind of comfortable with the music, it was a case of combining the two. But introducing them to the photos was interesting.
That's laid on later, was it?
Yeah, we added them in again after the music had been covered.
Because the score is so very, very challenging to learn and to sing, it was a really great idea to have them know it inside out. Their harmony lines, their melodies.
And they sounded beautiful. And I mean, they really did.
Yeah, right. And so...
hold on.
Yeah.
They're very talented.
They really are. And that was great, so we could put... And then present them with the images for Katie to take hold in.
Look, extra work, extra effort, extra meaning. But you pay off in spades, if I may say. And what next for you two? Either together or apart professionally?
I'm working on a new potentially musical theatre themed project at the Leicester Square Theatre.
Oh, jolly good.
More to be revealed soon.
I'll be interested to know what comes of that.
Yeah.
I'm London based. So.
Oh, great news. I'll keep you posted. Yeah.
And you, sir?
I've just graduated from uni. So
Which one?
Trinity College of Music in London. And this is the first job I've had since graduating. So hopefully there'll be a few more to come before Christmas.
This is your foundation stone from which your greatness will be built.
Exactly.
Yes. Like a challenging foundation stone. So.
Well, my thanks to you both. I really enjoyed the show.
Oh, thanks, Tamara. I hope
other people do, and I'm sure other people have. But I think you've done something very unusual here at the Fringe this year, which is, you know, you pulled off a genuine concept musical, at least to a British audience. You know, there's a lot of shows which describe themselves as concepts, but they're not, they're gimmicks. They're, you know, they take a perfectly normal narrative and add a gimmick to it and think that's a concept. This is the other way around. You have a concept piece, which is so difficult to get people to engage with.
Yeah.
But you have successfully.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. That's really good to hear, because I think it is the biggest challenge with the show is that there's no narrative and we've got to get people to engage with the music and the photos. So it's very nice to hear. Thank you.
You got people in and then you got them out again smiling.
Brilliant.
Musical talk. Well, my thanks to Katie Peskin and Michael Riley there for agreeing to talk to me. And I hope that interview also gave you just a little bit of a slice of what the weather was like in Edinburgh there, because the occasional popping or beating sound that you could hear towards the end of that recording was the rain landing on my microphone. I gave that show 4 stars and described it as beguiling and hypnotic. And it's truly a concept musical, or at least, as they say, a song cycle. But it's a song cycle with some linking, visually as well as in the staging and with the score. So I am inclined to call it more than just a song cycle and call it a truly concept musical, because it doesn't have a linear or indeed any real narrative. But it's nonetheless exciting for that. So now on to the 4th of our 4 fabulous shows we're discussing on Musical Talk today. And it's title of show, or more accurately, brackets title of show, close brackets. Appearing in Britain for its UK premiere. As you may or may not know, it was written by Hunter Bell and Jeff Bowen. And the reason it falls into this episode, where I've picked shows that have unusual framing devices, is because the show, as we've discussed previously on Musical Talk, is an odd verbatim reenactment, almost word for word, of what actually happened to Hunter Bell and Jeff Bowen when they wrote the musical. So it's meta-theatre. It refers to itself, but in an extremely playful way. So there's clearly a chronological story, but some of the characters feel they can only talk in the show when they've been allowed to do so because they've been spoken to by the 2 writers who appear in the show, if that makes sense. If it doesn't, then I hope the following conversation will at least give you some further insights into this fabulous title of show. It starred Carly Stenson, Robbie Towns, Ricky Johnson and Jamie Lee Pike, and frankly they work together like clockwork. They're a marvellous cast. And you may remember I caught up with them during rehearsals before Edinburgh in a previous episode of Musical Talk. Well, today you'll be hearing my conversation in Edinburgh with Alex Howarth, the director of the fantastic title of show. Musical Talk.
My name's Alex and I'm the director of Title of Show, which is currently happening at Assembly Checkpoint in Edinburgh.
We are halfway through the run as we record this.
Yeah.
And Alex, you had a hit last year with Putnam Spelling Bee. You've got a hit this year with Title of Show. How have you got this magic touch?
Oh, I don't know if the magic touch. I think it's just about working hard, I think, and getting the right people for the right parts and making sure you have that... The quality of show that people deserve to be seeing, you know. And
so how do you pick the show in the first place? That's what I'm interested in, because you seem to pick these, and you can tell me I'm wrong here, but shows which have got a great cult following haven't really ever been done. Well, they have been done in Britain, but not very much necessarily. Minimum runs, not necessarily
That's our main aim. We try to find things that, if they have been done here before, have not been seen by very many people. So at the time we did Spelling Bee, it had been at the Donmar, but for a very limited run. It was a very short run. It wasn't very well known. And this is the first ever professional production of Title of Show. There's been a few smaller scale amateur productions that I know Durham Uni did it last month. But we really want to find things that people haven't haven't seen before, and we've had a great response from this. We've had lots of people saying that they've come and seen the show for the first time, and then they've gone away and bought the cast album, yes, or they've gone and watched the title of show on. You know, so we've introduced them to something that hopefully they can now enjoy for a long time, which is fantastic. And a few years ago we did Godspell. You know, we're all for finding new ways of doing the more traditional stuff, but at the moment we're focusing on trying to find brand new, certainly things that are brand
new-ish,
to the UK, anyway.
Well, you seem to have hit the gold seam in this particular rock face, if you don't mind me saying, because, as I say, last year was a spot-on show. This year, fantastic stars are being thrown at it from all directions, in large numbers, it seems to me.
We've had some really nice reviews, and we're still waiting on some more, actually. I think that's another thing, because it's new, people are really interested in it. It's certainly not easy, and we've spent a lot of time working on press releases and talking to the media, but it is nice that they have that more immediate interest in you. And obviously with the experience of the guys we got this year, that's something else that people are interested in. So we've had a lot of reviewing bodies who certainly we didn't have last year, and some whom we've never had come see us before, which is really, really nice. It's really flattering, and hopefully now they've seen us once, they'll remember us and then come again next time, because obviously that's invaluable with marketing, certainly in Edinburgh, is getting the stars on your poster and on your flyer for people to, if you don't have at least one by this point, people are sort of thinking, what's gone wrong?
Yeah.
Which is highly unfair, I think, because a lot of people, certainly if it's your first year here, struggle to get reviewers in. So even if it's fantastic,
you're not seen.
Yeah. But no, it really helped. We're in a very lucky position now where we've got stars on the flyers from last year, and people know us, but saying they know to come and see. And
you've quite rightly developed a very good reputation, but let's talk about title of show. When exactly was the decision made to go with title of show? You know, what's your time scale to get it to here in Edinburgh?
It was very, very last minute this year, because I've been at Mount View this year, so Patch of Blues kind of had a year off. We were looking at a variety of things to do, and we'd almost signed to do another show.
For another year, yes.
which we're now hoping to go and do another year. But then the rights fell through with that, so we were almost not here at all. But then type of show came up. We were just browsing musicals, and it was one of those I was kind of aware of, but had never. And we listened to the soundtrack, and we felt it really fitted with what we're trying to do, both in terms of how well known it is, but in terms of a quirky, fun comedy that's a little bit different. So in this case, quite different.
And also
it's a great show to bring to the fringe in terms of practicality as well, with four actors and a musician, four chairs and a keyboard,
you can put that in the back of a van, including the actors.
We did, and we in fact shared a van with another company because we had such little stuff, which is great, but mostly because it really we felt it really fitted with what we were trying to do at the moment and our ethos. It worked out very well, but it was very, very last minute. I mean, Assembly were very, very good to, very kind to give us a slot, because at the time it took quite a while for the rights to go through, because it is the UK premiere.
Yes.
A lot of decisions had to be made. It had to go by Hunter and Jeff, and that took up until a week before the venue deadlines. So literally we were ringing round, and everywhere was taken, and it was a very nice man at Assembly who had took a chance on us and move some things around to be able to give us a slot, because he knew the show and he was keen to have the premiere at Assembly, and they've been fantastic. It's a lovely, lovely venue.
It's august, if I may say. Mm. It's a beautiful Victorian building, isn't it?
Yeah, it's really, really nice.
Tiled walls and vast spaces.
Yeah,
wood panelling, and goodness knows.
It's very, very nice, and it's a nice size downstairs. There is an upstairs, but we just haven't opened the upstairs. So although it's a very, very large capacity, it doesn't feel crowded. It's very, and it's a lovely stage for it. And we're the only musical here. There's another play, I believe in the morning, but everything else is music. So it's nice, to, and it's really, really central as well. It's just everybody. Even if people don't know exactly where it is, if you just say it's opposite Bedlam on the way to the Cow, then everybody knows where it is. So that's really helpful as well. People are very, very easily put off when you're giving somebody the sell with your flyer. Got them hanging by a thread, you know. It's one.
When you
little...
say it's in Leith, and they won't
go. Yes, no, absolutely. Well, yeah, one little thing will make them just go. So that it's great that we can be like, this is exactly where we are.
Well, this is also perfect for everything because you're a stone's throw from the Royal Mile. You're a stone's throw from Bristow Square, where there's so much going on. You know, you go to a show here and then immediately go off to show almost anywhere else and still make it in 10 minutes.
Yeah, it's great, and we're very, very close to our flat as well. We've got
you are lucky.
which is very, very nice. So our flat is just down from Grey Fries Bobby, which is great. So
in
we warm
vaults, then in Merchant Street.
We're just literally below the Elephant House,
which is
very, very nice. So we literally warm up in the flat at 2:15 and then walk straight here. So it's ideal. We've been very, very lucky, as I say, especially considering it was a little stressful. We won't be living it that late again. But yeah, it's all worked out. So it's great.
And it's such a clever show. I mean, it's also... what I like is the fact you've gone for several shows which are thoughtful and intelligent and emotional, but this is also clever because it's a meta-theatre piece in many ways, and yet it also follows the train of a conventional... You know, if your mind isn't... You know, people shouldn't be frightened by its meta-theatrical nature, because actually, if you just want to look at it baldly for what it is a story of two men writing a musical.
Absolutely, and it's a fantastic story. Not only is it a fantastic story, it's true. It's completely true. Absolutely, word for word, which I think makes it even more exciting. You know, it is an incredible story. You know, these two guys were literally just writing in their living room and they got it to Broadway, you know, entirely how you see it in the show with entirely under their own volition, which is a fantastic achievement, and it's a real... I think we got a review which described it as a charming underdog, which I think is absolutely what, you know, and they were, you know, they were the underdogs. They were absolutely, you know, they didn't have any money, they didn't, you know, and they did it completely themselves, and it's a fantastic story of triumph over adversity, but in a very non-cheesy way, I think, you know.
It's not that at all.
Yeah.
It's also got its, the relationships in it go up and down as they would in the circumstances, and in an entirely believable way. I mean, obviously it is based on reality, but, you know, the second act, which is interesting, because the first act is that traditional climb of, will we do it? Here we are. Can we get to the show? Oh, end of act one. Yes, we have.
Yeah.
I mean, act two is, of course, revivals, further development. Is it going to go well? What I'd like to do with it? Are we doing the right thing? I'm not sure I do want that to happen. You know, you get the real creative tensions it's Gilbert and Sullivan 100 years on.
I know, absolutely. And it's a really interesting relationship dynamic between the characters as well, because it's not, you know, there's no traditional love story or anything, you know, which you have in almost every musical that I can think of.
There is a so refreshing for that purpose. Yeah,
and there's absolutely none of that. You know, it is about them and their story and what they did.
Although there is a sense of an unrequited love. Love story is too strong a word, isn't it? But there's a sense that one character might be interested to go further than another.
Yes,
which is very true to life in a lot of cases.
It's interesting the there's extensive notes in the script on that bit and how it should absolutely not be played by this. Is like that this is, you know, he's desperately in love with him, but it's just the attempted kiss is just a reaction to a moment when you're very much in that and
and Lord knows how many people can say they have avoided that circumstance.
Well, absolutely. I think it's really different from and interesting from that point of view as well. It is such it, you know, in many ways it is a traditional musical because, you know, it follows four people triumphing against adversity, but also they're very, very different characters and a very, very different setup, and so I think it's really refreshing from that point of view as well.
The person I was with was also delighted by it because he thought that the female characters, who are the friends the two writers in this, and they get a lot of laugh lines quite often from the device of, you know, are we allowed to speak yet because we haven't said anything?
Yes,
you know, because
absolutely.
They are both real characters and also written characters. Mm-hmm. And it's true, it's not about them it's not about the female characters per se, but they are very strongly written.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, they're both very, very strong women. I mean, I've watched endless hours of side by side with Susan Blackwell, which is Susan's YouTube channel where she interviews Broadway stars, but she always has them doing something fun and interesting. Yes. Like she has Daniel Radcliffe cleaning her windows.
Well, you would, wouldn't
you? She takes Celia Keenan Bolger to the zoo, and they're very, very entertaining. And she that is what you see in the show is exactly how she, you know, she's very, very funny, very sassy, and that's the joy about this is that it is exactly what it says it is. They wrote down what happened to them and they made that into the musical. So it was very real, and we've worked very hard to make sure we try. Well, I feel like we've achieved that, the naturalism of the moment, do you know, and it not feeling like
they're acting. Feels like a false step. I mean, it's beautifully directed.
Thank you.
You had that one.
Thank you, but genuinely,
it is beautifully directed. It works like clockwork because it's four people. It really is. You know, it's an intricate little Fabergé egg, and every time it reveals itself almost. But there's so much more to it, and it just kicks along very nicely. It is sustained all the way through.
Which is a challenge because you've got the meta device of them being very aware they're doing a play. It is very much scene blackout, you know, which is something I usually try and avoid at all costs. Spelling Bee is almost in real time, unless without the flashbacks and the fast forward moment. You know,
well, indeed, they make a feature of that, don't they? When someone moves a chair.
Yeah, absolutely. So that was an interesting one for me to do something where you have to so fully embrace the theatrical nature of it. You know, last year we were very much trying to make, and as we all be on the tour, trying to make it feel as much like you're going to a spelling bee and you are in the audience at a spelling bee as possible, and as least like a show as possible. Whereas this, it's the complete opposite. You know, we are hammering around the head every 5 minutes that they are in a theatre and this is the show.
There's Brechtian alienation going on in spades here if you want it. Do you not think?
Yeah, well...
By which I mean that you can see it's a show that's occurring in front of you.
Yes.
Even though, if I suppose, let's play the game, it's also Stanislavian, if you want to, in the sense that it's...
No, I suppose...
But they live it, don't they? So.
Yeah.
All right. That takes us nowhere.
No, but we tried very much with that to bring the audience. You know, the guys were in the audience from the beginning, and they never bowed at the end. We tried to make it feel as much. But with this, it's been great to do something completely different from that. You know, because obviously,
any pressure on you as a director by the fact that it's the UK premiere? Did you? I mean, I don't mean the legal stuff and all that. I just mean, you know, you are the first to do this professionally in Britain.
Thank you. It is. There is added pressure with that. We've tried not to think of. You know, we try and. I mean, it sounds like a cliche, but we try and absolutely give our best with everything we do and throw ourselves in. So, you know, I like to think we would, regardless of the situation, even if it had been 10 years old, we'd still be giving it our absolute all and trying it. But no, of course that's true, and I'm being in. You know, such a prestigious venue now, and working with such high-profile actors. Do you know,
you've got West End.
Absolutely, and they're but you know they've been exactly the same as you feel the pressure going into rehearsals, but they've been wonderful. It's been no different from guys that we've always worked with. You know,
well, when I had the privilege of interviewing them during the rehearsal period, and they'd had a full day of rehearsal, and you know they were giving up some of their spare time to talk to me, but they were so good-natured and they sparked off each other so well. It's a beautiful conversation to listen to because they're having fun.
Absolutely.
You can hear that, and you think if you could still have fun after a day of rehearsing in a church with some unusual acoustics, and you know,
it was an interesting rehearsal space.
It was indeed.
But I think that's what's great about doing it here. I think, in the way, you know, because we had two very, very intensive rehearsal weeks, and that was it. And well, we continued rehearsals when we got here to Edinburgh, but it has been very much we've been completely together the whole time, and I think that's been fantastic for building the relationships that they then have within the show. Because if we'd been doing this in more, you know, traditional, you know, come to I'm thinking about when back in the day when we used to rehearse at St Andrews, you know, we'd sort of have rehearsals like 6 till 10, 2 or 3 times a week, you know. Yeah. And then, you know, you probably don't, you might go for a drink, but other than that, you probably don't see each other for the rest of the week. And I think this has been, it's been such a positive, because the four of them do get on so well. Robbie and Carly know each other from Legally Blonde. But other than that, from the West End production. And Robbie was first cover Emmett. So they had that as well. But other than that, they didn't know each other before this at all, and they're such good friends now, and they build up such a fantastic relationship. And I feel that's being in the environment that we've been in, and, you know, and living in a flat together and everything has given us an opportunity that maybe, you know, other productions wouldn't have to develop that closeness and that relationship, which is really nice.
Well, you can only grow orchids in a hothouse, can you not?
Absolutely.
So, what surprises you about the show? You know, you've been with it since its inception here in this production. You know, you're the director, you've seen it through, you're still here halfway through the run. You know, it's done tremendously well, but I suppose this is a two-part question, because, you know, what surprises you? And, of course, having an audience changes it every day. So what have you seen as a result of that?
It's really interesting to see how an audience has reacted to it, because it definitely does polarise opinion. And whilst we've had almost entirely positive feedback about our production, there have been a few people who it's not said that the show itself is not their cup of tea. But that's great. I think if we were pleasing absolutely everybody, I think
we wouldn't be pleasing them very much.
We wouldn't be pleasing them very. Yeah, no, yeah. Absolutely.
And it is a clever show, and some people just don't like. You know, some people just want to come in and see the dancing girls and go home again. You know, with the, whistling the sequins.
I think
you're not going to do that with this.
And
show.
it's certainly not that kind of. You know, if your bag is Rodgers and Hammerstein and Gilbert and Sullivan, this probably isn't going to be for you. But I think that's absolutely great.
As it happens, not Rodgers and Hammerstein. I was Gilbert and Sullivan, great friends. We're personal friends.
Oh, great!
I haven't returned any of my calls. But you know, this is a fabulous show as well.
Yeah,
you know?
Absolutely. So I think
I know what you mean. Yes, it's not for the people who are only traditional.
Yeah, and we've had days where it's been absolutely solid laughter throughout, and people, you know, and days when not so much. But I think it does entirely depend on the audience and who they, and it really, I mean they're absolute professionals. They give it they give exactly the same performance.
Oh, yes, it's 100% all the way, isn't it?
Every day, and they don't let that affect them, which is, I think, one remarkable and 100% necessary in this environment. You know, when you're on the West End, you're pretty much, yeah, certainly in one of the big shows, you know, you're pretty much guaranteed an almost full house every day. Whereas here, you know,
you're fighting for it.
You're absolutely fighting for it. Even, you know, on a sort of beginning of the week is a struggle for absolutely everybody. You know, but they, you know, all credit to them that absolutely they give it everything they've got, regardless. I'm very glad we're doing something that. People, we'd rather be 9 people's favourite thing.
Absolutely. But has there been moments in the narrative that have polarised public opinion as well? Have you spotted that on one day this has really flown and on another day that it's not?
I think the scenes with where it's literally two of them, one on one side of the stage, one on the front, having a phone conversation. Yeah. Some days that absolutely flies, you know, because it is very funny, it's very witty dialogue, and sometimes, but I think some audiences who, you know, maybe perhaps the more traditional musical theatre audiences who are not used to that kind of thing, and, you know, such like sparse dialogue in a musical, that, you know, some days it is met with less reaction than,
or just letting it be a narrative bridge rather than actually seeing if it has any substance in itself, because people do that as well,
absolutely.
Don't they? Some people just sort of say, right, okay, now for the words which will take me to the next song. It's a silly thing to do with this show, if you don't mind me saying.
It's very, very much not that kind of show at all. You know, it's all about the songs are fantastic, but the songs are the show pieces, and it's the dialogue that moves the story along. Right? So, again, I think if people are coming for that sort of thing, then it's perhaps not going to be their cup of tea as well.
Are you getting the aficionado audience? By which I mean, you know, we discussed previously, but there's a song which is entirely made up of flops and shows like that. And
absolutely, yeah. I think
that appeals to a certain kind of a theatre goer.
I mean, we talked about this at length because a lot of people were asking us, you know, if we were going to change up because a lot of it is so obscure, but I think that's kind of missing the point, because they say in the show, our rep before Die Vampire, you know, our references are so obscure, are we doing the right thing, should we change it? And you know, they're just as obscure to 99.9% of Americans, you know, unless you are an absolute ardent... most of the stuff I haven't heard. I had to go and look it all up. You know, so we are getting the people who know. But I would say most of the audience don't, and it's making the intentions behind the lines clear. And with that song, with Monkeys and Playbills, we've worked very hard in the choreographing of that to make it as clear as possible what's going on.
And I think you've succeeded. I mean, I don't think anyone realised. I don't think anyone thinks you have to know the shows to make that song work. You have to know what the shows represent.
Absolutely. And it's the, as I say, it's the intention behind the line. So it's making sure that the actors know what they're talking about. Yeah. Things like Quamina, we talked at length about.
I'd certainly never. Else,
yeah, absolutely. And knowing why they've referenced that specific show, so you can get the intention behind that line, and if that intention is conveyed to the audience, then that's what you need.
Does it amuse you? I think at least two of the songs in that are Merrily We Roll Along by Sondheim, which we have to remember was a failure when it first started.
Yes, absolutely. It's certainly not
and
now.
And King
no.
Kong, I think, is referred to, isn't it?
Oh my goodness! What is the title? It's a specific, because there is now obviously an extremely successful King Kong musical, but the one they're referencing is censored scenes from King Kong.
That's the specific name of the show,
which was a big flop. And
because it's not a household name. Let's put it. It's just that obviously a version of the King Kong musical was on in Edinburgh earlier in the run.
Yes, yeah.
And Merrily's also on. So
King Kong, the one in Edinburgh, they wrote themselves.
It's a new King Kong.
Oh, right. I chatted to the guy because I was like, is this legal? He said, no, it definitely is. He's checked it out. And then obviously there's the big one in Australia now. But yeah,
it was a fully independent New King Kong, where he was.
Yeah.
Well, you live and learn, because I didn't get to see it.
Oh, okay.
Who knew that he was ever so popular?
Yeah, no, they were singing on the mile. It sounded great. But obviously Merrily back in the day was a flop, which is horrendous. Like, you think, how could this be? You know, like, how many, you know, I want to go home and look through all, I think there's 53 musicals referencing that song or something.
Yeah.
I didn't go through and listen. You know, I'm sure some of them are terrible, but if some are not, you know, if any of them are the caliber of Merrily, you know,
things do fall through the cracks.
And it's individual productions as well. I would imagine if there's a bad production or something, people would just blame the show, and then they just never go back to it, you know. But thank goodness now it's been revisited.
It was because Sondheim brings things back out of the cupboard and they all come back to life again, don't they? He was famous for flops for most of his career. It seems hard to believe now.
It's crazy.
Now he's everyone's favourite of the month. But title of show. It's a fantastic show. I have said myself, it's witty perfection. And it is. It's witty all the way through. It's sustained. You've paced it beautifully. You know, your actors are scalpel sharp, I think.
They're great. We've been very, very lucky. And I think it really helps with Ricky's from New York and Robbie's Canadian. And I think that really helps for them to get... to get that humour and that pace in the dialogue and that New York feel, and it's been wonderful having Ricky, because he's answered so many questions that, you know, he talked to us about, you know, his time auditioning in New York and how, unless you're a member of, I can't remember what it, the equivalent of Equity, you go, you know, you get up at 4 in the morning, you get outside there for 5, and you're potentially sat there until 8 o'clock in the evening, and then they send you away and they don't even see you. You know, you only get a spot if somebody doesn't turn up who's a member and has had an audition scheduled in. And, you know, that is what the four of them are all going through. Do you know, when Heidi... We first see Heidi, she's come from a audition for Mamma Mia, and she's not got it, you know, to be replacement understudy stage manager. You know, and she,
97th in line, really.
Yeah. And, you know, to have that insight from him, from somebody who's been there and done it, is fantastic. You know, like.
My favourite quotation, an idea indeed, from when I met the cast when they were in rehearsal, was the fact that because Ricky and Robbie, as you say, are both North American, mm-hmm. and Ricky himself is from New York, that the British members of the cast found it quite difficult to work out when they were stopping being in character and were just talking themselves about what they heard, because the show is so meta as well. It was
that's
beautiful thing.
Yeah, absolutely. And that, you know, that's what we've been, if that's the case, then that's fantastic, because that's what we've been really striving for, to have it be so natural that you don't. Somebody came and chatted to us afterwards and compared it to Showstoppers. Which is great, you know, because they said they felt like it was
seamless.
It was just being created before them, you know, which is fantastic. That's what we're after. So,
well, the title of show is a 5-star show. It's not just me who's saying so, but it is me who's saying so amongst other people. So, you know, congratulations.
Thank you very, very much.
Is it going anywhere further after here, or do we know? Not know.
We don't know at the moment. We would really absolutely love to continue
further.
With it, to take it further. But it all depends on the success of the,
take
of
it on
the
tour.
Production. Absolutely. I mean, that
title of Roadshow.
Title of Roadshow. That would be pretty copyright. That. Yeah. We would absolutely love to continue, but we're gonna have to see what happens.
But people could find out by going to your website, could they not?
Absolutely.
Would they not be the simplest way?
They could go to www.ourtitleofshow.com, and there's some lovely production photos up there as well.
Indeed, yes.
And on Twitter we are at Our Title of Show, which is great, and there's a couple of trailers on there as well, which is so lovely. So please do come along.
And the production company, we should mention you, because, you know, forgive me, you're already a hothouse of excellence. So,
oh, thank you very much.
We want to know what's coming next.
That is a very, very good question. So we have our Spelling Bee tour, which is very, very exciting.
Brilliant.
So that is patchbluetheatre.co.uk, and Spelling Bee will be on tour from the beginning of October until the end of November.
Oh, fantastic.
And we're going to some wonderful places: Grand in Blackpool, the Royal Court in Liverpool, Theatre Royal in Jersey, Opera House in Jersey, some
length
really
and breadth of the country.
Yeah, some really, really lovely places. So we're really, really excited about that. And we have 5 members of the original cast from last year, and then 5 new people as well. So that's taking us up to November, and then there is a Christmas show in the works at the moment, but certainly nothing is set in stone.
We can't say yet, but once again, go to the website to find out.
Absolutely, absolutely. But thank you very, very much,
Alex. It's a pleasure meeting you again. It's a pleasure seeing your shows, and I rather hope to see you again to have more conversations about more shows.
I hope so. I hope so. Thank you very, very much.
Musical Talk. Well, that was the wonderful Alex Howarth, representing Patch of Blue Theatre, talking to me about Title of Show, a musical about two guys writing a musical about two guys writing a musical for a festival at the festival, which is how it was advertised as a byline on the programme to the show if you went. And what did I think of Title of Show? Well, you must have realised by now I liked it. I gave it 5 stars and called it witty perfection. And I'd be glad to see that again. And don't forget Patch of Blue Theatre's stunning The Putnam 25th Annual Spelling Bee, which appeared at Edinburgh last year and was so good, has been reassembled with most of the same cast to go on a national tour. So do look that up. You won't be disappointed. Well, at last, you must be saying, we've come to the end of this edition of Musical Talk, where we've been looking at the framing devices often used in musical theatre and picked out 4 examples where that's been used to truly great effect. And what a delight to be able to say, 4 shows and 19 stars between them. That's a pretty high strike rate. But it's now time for me to go. And as we started today's episode near enough with the opening theme tune to the musical show Get Got, called Showbiz Today Tonight, it's entirely appropriate that we finish with the same theme tune. It's worth hearing again, and as the TV programme, if you had seen it live, would have done the same thing, what better way to end? Goodbye.
Show, and that's how it's gotta go on Showbiz Today Tonight.
Episode of Musical Talk presented and edited by Thos Ribbits. Copyright Musical Talk 2013, except for the song Showbiz Today Tonight, which had music and lyrics by Miss City and Chaston, and where the copyright remains with the original creators. And my thanks to the people behind that show for letting me play the music. And I'm just going to move this table a little bit closer to you, if that's okay. Just at the moment, I feel like the Lord of the Manor at the other end of a dining table. And unless the butler comes along, we won't have anything at all. Right, split. Thank you. That's very kind.